Welcome everyone to this first in the series of seminars or webinars on the topic of graphic landscape. We're just going to wait for a moment or two. We've got a lot of people have signed up to join us today, so we want to give everyone the chance to join us in this virtual space, and we'll start in earnest in a minute or two's time. But it's great to see so many of you joining us already. I can see on the screen in front of me, the numbers are racing up. We've already got more than 80 participants. So, and we're hoping for quite a few more. So please, if you wouldn't mind waiting and being patient, we'll start in a minute or so. Yes, hello again. Just to say, my name is Mark Hallett, and I'll be co-chairing this session, but we're just waiting for a moment or two longer before we start properly to allow people to join us. The numbers are still going up on the screen in front of me, so I wanted to wait until that pause so I get a sense that we're pretty much full house. And as Danny is saying through the chat box, my colleague Danny Convey is asking you to let us know where you're joining us from. It's really helpful for us and interesting for us to find out where you're watching us. And typically we find that we've got people joining us from all over the world. Whether you're in a far-flung space or whether you're a neighbor of ours, please let us know where you're joining us from. It's really good for us to get a sense of our audience and their location. We're getting people from Chicago, Buckinghamshire, London, Leicester, Birmingham, Swansea. Very exciting to know that we're reaching such an audience, a broad audience. Kansas, Herefordshire, great. And from New York and Oxford too. Great, I think we'll start. The numbers are pausing or slowing, so I think we should kick off so we can give ourselves as much time as possible to have a really good discussion on this exciting topic. So welcome everyone. My name's Mark Hallett. I'm director of the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And today I'm really delighted to be co-chairing the first of four, or the four sessions that make up our online webinar programme, Graphic Landscape, the Landscape Print Series in Britain, circa 1775 to 1850. I'm doing so alongside my co-convener, the co-convener of this entire series, Felicity, Myrone, who's the lead curator of Western prints and drawings at the British Library. So today's session is entitled Print, Politics and Industrialisation. But before we start in earnest, we thought it'd be helpful to provide some basic housekeeping information about the event. So as it says here, the session will contain three 20-minute papers, in fact, followed by a panel discussion and a Q&A. After the second paper, there'll be a short 10-minute comfort break. Around 1 o'clock, we'll pause for a few minutes to give everyone a chance for a break and to refresh themselves before we turn to our third paper that Morna is going to be giving. Now, whether while you're listening or when we come to the actual Q&A period of the webinar, please be feel encouraged to type in questions using the Q&A function. Felicity and I will be able to then field those questions to our speakers. And I'd really encourage you all to try and submit questions responding to the talks you've been listening to, whether about the interpretation that the speakers have been making, whether the facts, the information about the materials they're talking about, whatever it is you'd like to contribute, we'd very much welcome. Just to say that the session will be recorded and made available to the public, and that if you should need or require closed captioning, it is available. Just click the CC button on your screen to enable captions to be seen. And for those of you who don't yet know us that well, I just wanted to say that the Paul Mellon Centre is a research institute and an educational charity that exists to support the most original, rigorous and stimulating scholarly research on British art and architecture of all periods. We endeavour to make this research as accessible as possible. I'd urge all of you to explore and enjoy the packed array of open access online events we've put together for this autumn and winter. It's an amazing program of things, I think, of which the graphic landscape webinars are just one part. And before I turn to Felicity to properly introduce today's session, I just wanted to mention that our suite of graphic landscape webinars has been devised as part of a wider project that we are conducting at the Centre entitled Generation Landscape. This project, which will encompass a variety of events and programmes and publications, is designed to provide fresh perspectives on the interlinked careers and work of that famous generation of landscape artists that included Turner and Constable, that also included hundreds, if not thousands, of less well-known, but often highly fascinating practitioners. Our quartet of seminars represents the first major scholarly iteration of this wider project. I hope many of you visiting us today will continue to participate as a wider generation landscape project unfolds. The project as a whole, and this webinar series more particularly, are built on collaboration and collegiality. I'm really pleased that in hosting and promoting these webinars, these four webinars, the PMC is working so closely with the British Library. And more particularly, I'm really very grateful to have been able to work with Felicity Myrone in shaping the character of these webinars, in crafting together the call for papers, and in thinking more generally about how best to approach the topic of the landscape print series in late Georgian and early Victorian Britain. So I'd like now to turn over to Felicity herself to introduce our speakers today, but first of all, to talk a bit more about the topic of graphic landscape and the landscape print series itself. So Felicity, over to you.
Thank you, Mark. We've framed this seminar series, Graphic Landscape, around areas of shared interest between Mark and myself. Crucially, the intersection between print history and landscape imagery, the possibilities for exploring the canon of landscape art and expanding definitions of the genre, and considering more concretely its forms, formats, and material contexts. Mark approaches these topics as an art historian. My own training is in art history, but I've worked as a curator at the British Museum and latterly at the British Library. And it is in this latter role that I've gained new perspectives on print and landscape, which are only just beginning to be more widely explored. This seminar series promises to provide an expanded sense of the graphic landscape, connecting landscape images with historical experience, patterns of consumption, and the realities of connecting and the realities of display and publishing in multiple and fascinating ways. By focusing on serial publications, these issues are brought to the fore in a way which is rarely the case when we focus on the singular image, the sole framed landscaped view, which risks being detached from the historical context of its distribution and reception. As the papers we'll hear today will demonstrate, the role of print in disseminating the landscape image and the role of print series in generating narratives, connections and potential links between landscape and experience, image by image, is a rich territory, even while focusing on relatively familiar, even canonical artists. But what I hope we can also keep in mind is the visual materials, the resources, and the possibilities which still lie beyond even this expanded view. From the perspective of the British Library collection, the series and the artists considered here are still only the tip of an iceberg. There, we've recently recatalogued and digitised George III's collection, the King's Topographical Collection, which can now be accessed via the main catalogue and Flickr. And we've produced a website, Picturing Places, through a research project entitled Transforming Topography. But the sheer extent of graphic landscape production there and elsewhere remains largely unassessed, as so much of it sits within volumes collected and catalogued as books or even as maps. They have not been catalogued or listed in ways which would encourage art historians to seek them out. As today's papers will reflect, in the last decade or so, the category of topography has been opened out to reveal a more extensive and complex field of activity than had hitherto been considered. But even that only goes so far. Topography is one class of landscape imagery among many. As much as this series sets out to open up the category of landscape, and by focusing on serial publications, it promises to do so in exciting ways. But we are still, I think, testing the ground and only starting to look beyond the art historical canon to a history of landscape imaging, which is preserved not only in art museum collections, but also importantly in libraries, local history collections, and in antiquarian societies. So today, there are full biographies for each of our speakers online, and I'm going to keep our introductions very brief. I'm delighted to welcome our first speaker today, Dr. Amy Concannon, who is Senior Curator of Historic British Art at Tate.
Could we quickly, we're going to pop over to Mark for the introduction because Felicity's sound is coming in and out a little bit, if that's okay.
Yes, thanks very much. Yes, we're going to keep it very brief, Amy. I think that was the plan all along. Delighted to welcome Amy Concannon as Senior Curator of Historic British Art at Tate, where she's worked since 2012 and co-created numerous exhibitions, including Turner's Modern World, which a very recent show at the Tate. But now we'll turn over to you, Amy, for your talk, which takes us into the world of the landscape print and images of Bristol. Is a really particularly interesting time in its history. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you everyone for coming, and thank you to Felicity and Mark for the invitation. I hope everyone can hear me. I'm just going to share my screen. And this. Does that look okay to everyone?
It's working. Thanks, Amy.
Okay, well, I'll dive straight in. The title of this sheet, bearing 10 images, Views of the Fires in Bristol on October the 30th, 1831, when houses, warehouses and property to the amount of £100,000 were destroyed, that's its full title, withholds a vital piece of information that has the potential to alter our reading. It speaks nothing of the cause. Fire and its visual effects are presented as the object of interest here, under the somewhat pedestrian title of Views. Indeed, these are views of Bristol, which together present all of its key topographical sites from typical viewing stations. But while we may be viewing a topographical series, this was no ordinary set of views. These images do not depict an everyday landscape, but rather a fleeting moment. They cannot, as was the case for so many other topographical series, claim to play a role in the bolstering of Britain's image as a peaceful and prosperous nation, ingeniously utilising its land and natural assets. These images run counter to the usual intent of such other views, and indeed overturn the image of Bristol that the artists behind them had conjured in their work hitherto. For these fires were the result of arson attacks by a crowd frustrated with corruption and the abuse of power, who were spurred into action by Parliament's rejection of the Reform Bill a year before its eventual passing. The chaos of these reform riots gripped Bristol for 3 days at the end of October 1831. The sheet you see here, this is a detail from the bottom half, and indeed most of the images I will discuss today can't be considered a series in the usual sense, but I will treat them as interconnected by their subject matter. They were also interconnected by their authorship and belonged to a very particular moment in time. The scenes printed here are very clearly intended to be read in dialogue with one another, and they would have also been read in dialogue with other prints and written accounts of the riots. The artists that I will be speaking about all knew each other, their professional lives overlapping by periods of residency.
Hi, Amy. I'm just going to stop you for a minute. You're coming through quite tricky as well. So I think possibly I might try and share your screen first.
Okay.
Yeah, you're coming through quite slowly. I wonder if it's the...
Should I? It might be the some of the... I've got a Yale image in there, which might be slowing it down. Should I stop my share and you share it?
Yes, if that's okay, I'll share it on your behalf. Apologies. In general, I think there is some sort of things seem to be going quite slowly on our end in general today. I wonder if the internet's a bit tricky. Please do let me know when to change to the next slide.
Okay. Hopefully this will work. I can't now see my PowerPoint, but we'll keep going. So the artists I'll be speaking about today all knew each other, their professional lives overlapping by periods of residency in Bristol. They knew one another through training, sharing studio space, collaboration, mutual patrons, and sketching trips. Now, I made this rather rudimentary diagram for my own record, really. I hadn't originally intended to show it, but I thought it was useful to visualize that network and the connections between these characters. And while it's not within the bounds of this paper to debate the existence of a coherent Bristol school, as these artists were retrospectively labelled, the riots activated existing relationships, sparking collaborations between artists, booksellers and publishers, both in Bristol and in London. Connections evident from the prints that arose from this moment. This network, and as I will show, the prints that arose from the riots speak of the strong culture of landscape production that flourished in Bristol in the 1820s. But unlike much of the work these artists had done, predominantly for local patrons, the riots and the circulation of their image in lithography, a fast and, as I'll show, appropriate mode of reproduction for works like these, presented a chance to reach beyond their local market to a national and even international one. Next slide, please. The visual documentation for the Bristol riots is unparalleled by comparison to other political crowd events. Of a reform rally at Peterloo in Manchester in 1819, or the anti-Catholic Gordon riots of 1780. The painted and printed depictions of the Bristol riots have received some attention, predominantly from art historians interested in the Bristol artists behind them, and cultural historians looking at crowds and the depiction of cities. I think they deserve greater prominence for the way in which they register political trauma on the landscape, and particularly the urban landscape itself. The fabric of Bristol was certainly left scarred by these riots. Almost overnight, key civic sites were left in smouldering ruins that physically manifested the breakdown of civil society. The city here had, metaphorically speaking, been burning for several decades. The city was a tinderbox of division. Bristol's governing corporation, dominated by merchants whose wealth was based on the exploitation of the West Indies and slavery, had long been perceived in the city as corrupt, and they were against political reform. But by the 1830s, reform fever had taken root across Britain. And while the rejection of the Reform Bill in 1831 caused unrest in other British cities, none of those disturbances compared to Bristol. Over 3 days, sites of civic importance, including the Customs House, the Bishop's Palace, and the city's three prisons, were raided and ruined. Next slide, Shauna. The circulation of prints of the riots overturned the image of Bristol that had, despite social tensions lurking underneath the surface, promoted this city as a calm, morally upstanding and productive place, a message that was visually defined by images which presented forests of ships' masts, a skyline dominated by many churches, streets devoid of dirt and bustle, and a city set within an undulating landscape that invited some commentators to compare it to Rome. Amongst the prints arising from the riots, this sheet is unique in its mise en page. Them a distant view of the city from east and from west, each flanked by four smaller ones. On the catalogue record at Bristol Museum, an art gallery, there are two artists associated with these images, Samuel Jackson and James Baker Pine. Yet the printed credits on the sheet itself record only one, Samuel Jackson. Both these artists were born in Bristol and shared a studio at one time. Depictions of Bristol, its urban landscape and its surroundings were central to both of their practice. Next slide. These views are typical of the kind of work that they were known for in the city. And as such, these artists had knowledge of the best viewpoints and the specific iconographic hallmarks of Bristol's urban landscape, all of which would have enabled them to work efficiently gathering material on the night the riots took place. Next slide, please, Shauna. Some of the monochrome watercolours by Jackson that formed the basis for the prints are seen here, and oil sketches by Pine can also be connected to this sheet too, though as stated, he is curiously not credited on the sheet itself. Next slide. One wonders whether the appearance of this steel engraving was a way to assert his authorship of this particular image. If you click forward again, and another image will come up. It shows his name prominently etched in the foreground in the same manner as Turner often did. And this perhaps speaks of Pine's assertion of his ambition. When it comes to ambition and self-definition, it's interesting to note that Jackson and Pine chose to describe themselves differently in the 1830 trade directory for Bristol. Jackson listed himself as a drawing master. His identification with this relatively humble and steady job fits the description of him given by fellow Bristol dwelling artist Francis Danby, who lamented that Jackson possessed, and I quote, a genius he had not shown on account of his propensity to screw down his heart for the getting of halfpence. Of course, this plays into the trope that a true artist thinks only of their calling and academic recognition before they think of money. But there is a comparison with Tyne to be made, who, despite also being a drawing master, described himself in that same trade directory in a more aggrandizing fashion. I think this sense of the artist's ambition is important. Next slide. By comparison to other prints arising from the riots, this sheet doesn't bear any sense of hurried reportage. Thinking again about its title, Views of the Fires in Bristol, which not once mentions the word riot, the sheet conveys a sense of distance from the chaos. The two images that occupy privileged positions are prospects, devoid of the specific detail of three nights of rioting. Glimpses of crowds are restricted to those smaller scenes at the site. And while contemporary viewers would immediately associate this sheet with the particular event, I think this sheet seems to be about aestheticizing riots, treating it as a sublime spectacle that, framed predominantly from a distance, sheds any sense of immediate threat, suppressing associations of fear and instability. Jackson and Tyne were both associates of Francis Danby, a heavy investor and proponent of the sublime landscape. And the riots offered them the opportunity to elevate the depiction of Bristol's urban landscape into something more, a chance for these artists to engage in the loftier register of the sublime, while also utilizing their knowledge of local topography and their skills in this genre to create images with varied appeal, from the overview of the burning city to the more detailed depictions of localized fires. Next slide, please, Shauna. The prospect view appears to have dominated. Jackson's view from Clifton Wood was isolated from the sheet and circulated in a larger format, again using lithography, and this version is hand-colored. While also being a practical position for an artist to assume, away from the chaos at a safe distance, this was also the vantage point onto the riots that the more affluent members of Bristol society had. Those living in fashionable new builds in the suburb of Clifton, for example. Published 4 years after the riots, Clifton, a poem by a resident gentleman, remembered how, quote, it seemed to those from hence who gazed as if a captured city blazed. This familiar prospect maximized opportunity for collectors to compare peaceful Bristol and blazing Bristol. The landmarks of St. Mary Redcliffe Church, the cathedral, ship's masts, glass furnaces on the right, and even a cow to signify the bucolic Clifton Down are all there. Jackson was using then his own genius and knowledge of his prospective market, local gentlemen who had viewed the fires from Clifton Hill, to collectors nationwide, for whom a single impression of the city ablaze sufficed to get that halfpence, to use Danby's words. When advertising this lithograph, next slide please, another distant view, encompassing all of Bristol's key features again from the same vantage point as one of Jackson's in the sheeted print. It was noted that the London press had reported it, and I've got an image of this quote, if you press the next slide. This was reported to be a desirable illustration to any future description of Bristol and even the history of England. The advert states that this print could be bound up with various histories of Bristol or, quote, form a desirable addition to the scrapbook or portfolio. So what appeal might the multi-view sheet have? Next slide. Drawing again on the characteristics of landscape production in Bristol prior to the riots, the panorama, a format more comprehensive than the typical view, is another strong theme. There was a camera obscura there, it's still there today at Clifton, and Jackson and Robotham, responsible for the prospect views, worked to produce an exhaustively comprehensive collection of watercolours of Bristol for local collector George Ware Brackenridge, a major commission that took place over a number of years that culminated in a set of panoramas. While the collective title for the sheet might be something of an understatement, the multi-view format compensates by communicating in one glance the complexity and extent of the riots as a multi-site event, and in that sense gives a kind of panorama of the riot action. A topographical collector's desire for completeness might be satisfied then by this sheet, but so too might the amateur chronicler of local history. They might value its comprehension, seeing it as an economical means by which to extra illustrate published narratives accounts, or as the advert suggested, histories of Bristol or England. It is easy to imagine that the sheet might be cut in half and bound into an octavo-sized volume. As Lucy Peltz has described in her study of extra illustration, this kind of vignette-based format might also appear to newer modes of grangerization, in which collectors would cut and paste images into scrapbooks, with or without text, enabling them to create highly personalized topographies and narratives of their own. This format therefore had much to offer the consumer. Next slide, please. This leads me to consider the use of lithography. Apart from a few outliers, the bulk of prints relating to the Bristol riots utilise this process, many of them recording collaborations between artists. This collaborative spirit had previous form. In 1823, 8 years before the riots, three Bristol artists, Jackson, Danby and James Johnson, had united to issue an ambitious but ultimately loss-making folio of landscape lithographs of Bristol. In the ensuing years, over the 1820s, the market for lithography grew, thanks to London-based lithographer Charles Hill Mandel and his association with the publisher and entrepreneur Rudolf Ackermann. Hill Mandel was responsible for printing several of the Bristol riot prints. Now, apart from one early project involving some Royal Academicians, the process of lithography was relatively distanced from the Academy and had heavily commercial associations, owing to its application to subjects with broad market appeal, those which benefited from the ease with which fine detail and watercolour-like washes could be rendered, like landscape and architecture. It was also economic too, enabling a large edition from a single drawing made on a prepared block of limestone. In France, however, the practice had different connotations. Because an artist could draw their image directly onto the stone, the French Academy promoted lithography for its ability to retain a sense of the artist's touch, as much for its expressiveness as for its ability to register fine detail. It was also a relatively quick way to make a print. So for a subject that was topical and required swift circulation to capitalize on interest, it was a good choice. Indeed, next slide. It was the means by which French artists Hippolyte Bellanger circulated their depictions of the July Revolution of 1830. Comparisons, mostly derogatory and undermining, were made in the press between the ways in which Bristolian and French rebels conducted themselves. But certainly the occasions of the Bristol riots and the July Revolution shared worrying similarities for those in power. Next slide, please. The choice of lithography for the Bristol riot images might have also been calculated to suit the market across the channel too. Certainly two of the prints I've shown, including this one on the left, were jointly published in Paris. The riots stimulated a network of print and France. Next slide. This lithograph, published in Bristol, was distributed by shrewd print seller Charles Tilt, who published images from the July 1830 revolution in France. Has it gone on? Let me just check. Please, could you just move it on? Thank you. So this was published in Bristol, distributed by Charles Tilt, who also published images from the July 1830 revolution in France, and it sold both in London and Paris. It was made by Louis Arge, who would go on in partnership with William Day to challenge Hall Mandel's dominance in the field of lithography. I've already mentioned Hall Mandel and his London press behind the sheet of 10 lithographs. He may have been brought on by second generation Bristol bookseller and picture dealer John Norton, who published that sheet and catered generally for the higher end of the trade. That's okay, you can move on. Other prints had more localized production. Thomas Bedford, who described his occupation in Bristol's trade directories as a lithographic printer, printed these images after sketches by Pine. I've had to go through it quite quickly, but I hope that this rather hastily built up picture of the who's who behind these prints should, I hope, conjure a sense of the active printmaking and selling infrastructure that sprung into action, activating commercial exchanges between Bristol and London and Paris too. There was also a degree of skills transfer, but it's highly likely that it was through direct or indirect interaction with Hall Mandel's guides and his 1824 treatise on lithography that Bristol's artists, like many others up and down the country, came to produce their own lithographs. Next slide, please. To close, I want to introduce John Skinner Prout's Picturesque Antiquities of Bristol from 1834, which was also printed by Holmandel. This project was calculated to appeal to the taste and arguably political leanings of the city's antiquarian collectors who, in the context of an anxiety-inducing present, characterised by political reform and the end of slavery in British colonies and signs of economic decline, might value its purported focus on, quote, olden times. The same year this volume was published, the Bristol Gazette opined, quote, can we fully and honestly say that we are proud of Bristol's situation in the scale of British cities? Alas, the answer must be negative. Bristol really was sinking down the chart of prosperous places, and the riots set the seal on the city's declining pride and self-image, certainly for another few years. Prout's volume presented an aspect of Bristol's identity, of which its citizens could have pride, recording and memorialising the city's antiquarian, be it from riots or new development. The advertisement for this volume promised escapism for the viewer to be engrossed. Next slide. Its striking avoidance of the modern was one such way in which the volume offered escapism. Prout's filling of the picture plane with his subjects to the exclusion of their context filtered out the harsher social, economic, and atmospheric realities of life in Bristol. And while the cumulative effect is appropriately for a city unable to contain its social tension, one of fragmentation and distortion, within the context of prints arising from the riots, I shall concentrate on the fact that there's only one image in which Bristol's urban landscape bears the imprint of modernity. The next slide, please. And that's this image of the Bishop's Palace in ruins. The figure sketching is a feature that connects this image to a self-referential tradition of antiquarian draftsmanship exhibited by Piranesi, French painter Hubert Robert, and Turner. The feature is also seen in the work of John Sell Cotman, whose drawings Prout would have studied in the collection of the Norwich-born curate of Bristol's St Mary Redcliffe, the Reverend James Bulwer, who arrived in the city in 1830. While the figure sketching might aid the viewing of the ruins as a purely aesthetic spectacle, objectified for close study and the practice of sketching, the inclusion of this image distinguishes Prout's series from the vast majority of picturesque compendiums. Ruin imagery might normally trigger associations of conflicts past and lessons for the present, of the hubris of human endeavour. But this is complicated by the riots as being a modern act of ruination. Next slide, please. That's it. The forms of decayed buildings, The forms of decayed buildings backlit by flames recall the convention of ruins backlit by brilliant Italian sunshine. These references played into questions on the potential fragility of modern Britain, which could very well go the same way as classical Rome. But present day society is implicated here. Those prints with titles that explicitly mention the riots, not just as fires, trouble and challenge the picturesque lens by reference to the uncomfortable reality of the present day and the destructive legacy of a very divided Britain. Next slide. Taken together, these prints arising from the Bristol riots, be they issued as single images or as part of a series, dramatically subverted representation of the city to that point, a picture which had been built up by the work of the very same artists behind these prints. Their topographical knowledge and skills were key in presenting the riots with clarity and speed. Their compositions were complemented by labelling, from prison to bishop's residence to customs and toll houses. The symbolism of the places targeted by riots transformed Bristol into a cipher for a crisis that was national. Every major city had such buildings and places for crowds to gather, and as such, these prints communicated the message that every city was at risk. These artists' local knowledge, skills, and networks made for an efficient machine of production and circulation, aided by lithographic printing, the choice of which made a connection with French practice and French politics. While I can't exactly say that these artists made fortunes from this moment, the riot images do mark a departure point for this network. Some, like Tyne, he who had identified himself as a landscape artist in Bristol's trade directory, moved to London shortly after. But Samuel Jackson, he who had identified himself as a drawing master, within Bristol, moving to the genteel suburb of Clifton and becoming the city's most prominent resident artist. Watercolours that he made of the suspension bridge designs showed a more optimistic Bristol landscape, its object of modern spectacle, no longer a frightening blaze, but now a technological wonder. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amy, that was great. Apologies to everyone for the sound issues we've both been having, but thank you very much, Amy. And we'd now like to welcome Dr. Lizzie Jacklin, who's Keeper of Art at Tyne and Weir Archives and Museums.
Hi, hi from Northumberland, and thank you very much for having me. I hope everybody can hear okay. So my focus today is Thomas Hare's Views of the Collieries in the Counties of Northumberland and Durham, published between 1839 and 1844. And this series of etchings takes us on a journey around the collieries and coal transport hubs of Northeast England at a time when the area known as the Great Northern Coalfield was crucial to fueling the country's firesides and industry, with steam power allowing the winding and pumping of engines and the rapid expansion of rail. As the collieries that he depicted were ultimately transient additions to the landscape, Thomas Hare's endeavour is credited as providing some of the only surviving views of the region's mining landscape during the first half of the 19th century. And this series, and particularly the watercolours it is based on, has received sporadic attention since the 1960s. And in particular, Douglas Glendenning's illuminating research accompanied exhibitions of the watercolours between 2000 and 2010. And this paper aims to spotlight the series again with expanded consideration of the wider context of landscape prints at the time that Hare published his views, and also of how this series might have been consumed. The text accompanying Hare's prints was by local historian Marvin Ross, and it emphasises the publication's aim to reveal the impact of coal on the region's landscape, describing the margins of our noble rivers fringed with the staves and machinery necessary for effecting the shipment of the jetty treasure, with the places depicted described as full of bustle and activity. Thomas Harrison Hare then was an artist, etcher and engraver from the Newcastle area, actually based in Camden in London at the time of this project, although he apparently still spent considerable time in the Northeast, and the Northeast makes up much of his subject matter. Very little is known about his life beyond the details of his birth, death and addresses, though we do know he exhibited some paintings at the Royal Academy and was involved in print series, including the project we're exploring today, which is the thing that he is primarily remembered for. Hare, who is assumed to have been professionally trained as an engraver, chose etching to translate his own series into print. He etched several of the views himself and employed Joseph Brown to etch several of those, including the one that you can see at the moment, with the remaining views etched by three other engravers. So to start with the prints themselves, the image on your screen now is perhaps one of the most visually impactful in the series of 40 views. And it shows Percy Main Colliery, a colliery which belonged to the Percy family in what was then a pit village, and is now part of the wider area of North Shields on the River Tyne, not far from Newcastle. This colliery had been sunk in 1799 and was open for a century before it closed. Hare's prints are based on watercolour views he made between 1828 and 1842, and so it was quite a long-term endeavour in that way. 42 of the watercolours survive in the Hatton Gallery collection in Newcastle University, which is how I came to be interested in the series. And before they came to the Hatton in the 1990s, They seem to have been permanently displayed in the now defunct mining faculty of what is now Newcastle University, having previously been owned by a local coal owner. Okay. So this map just quickly indicates for you the area that we're talking about, with the setting for each one of the views represented in her series, seen with a red dot. So you can hopefully see that quite a bit of the activity was focused around Newcastle, and we also have views further south in County Durham and the coastal hubs where the coals were shipped from. And you can see too the watercolour that the Percy Pitt view was based on. And Hare often chose this vignette-like format for the watercolours and the finished prints, though they're quite large in scale. I think all previous writing on Hare's views has emphasised their historic value in terms of their accurate depiction of topography that's now lost. And topographical accuracy is also emphasised in the publication's preface, which states, "The design of this work has been to afford faithful delineation of the various objects connected with the working and shipment of coal, and not to produce a display of pictorial beauty at expense of truth to nature." Still, I think images like this one reveal interest in the dramatic potential of industrial subjects, with silhouetted figures seen looking on in the burning braziers, contrasting against the darker surroundings. So I find her statements and views in relation to the ideas that we've seen recently from scholars, including Felicity, Myrone, and John Barrell, around the ways that topographical prints have perhaps sometimes been categorized too separately or considered simply descriptive. And clearly for this series, accuracy is really important, but there are still lots of other things happening too, and it's quite a complex image and has a lot to reveal following study. And in this print, we see her engaging with both a specific and changing landscape, but also an atmosphere in the wake of the sort of industrial activity that's happening. This view is probably more typical of the series as a whole, and we see the way that her sets mining-related activity into the context of a wider and actually calmer landscape. And the colliery shown in the background here was still a recent addition to the landscape in 1826. Just to give an idea that Hare was probably seeing the landscapes of his own youth sort of changing around him. And that's one of the things that we believe he was interested in depicting. Most of the works reveal a close relationship between the watercolour and the finished print. But there are some differences, and here if you look at the boat and the two images, for example, you can see that Hare made some changes, and perhaps it's relevant that this particular plate he etched himself. Oh, sorry. Yeah. So this view shows a pit somewhere south of Sunderland. And the accompanying text in the publication is relatively short, so it might serve to give you a flavour of the kind of description that accompanied the prints, written by Marvin Ross, but I suspect with considerable input from Hare. So for this view, the publication noted, "This colliery, which receives its name from a lech or brook in its vicinity, is situated about a mile west from Hetton and is the property of the Marquess of Londonderry. It was sunk in the summer of 1824, and the shaft is 80 fathoms deep." And he goes on to note how the water passes from the workings and details of the winding engine before stating, "The coals are shipped at Seaham Harbour by means of the railway from Pittingdon and Hetton. The quantity in heap give the colliery that volcanic appearance which we have endeavoured to represent in our view." While we can't know for sure, I don't think, if Hare really witnessed the phenomenon of surface fires burning on the coal heaps or not, it's quite interesting that the text takes pains to emphasise that the drama we see in the scene represents the actual appearance of the heaps. Meanwhile, this view of Jarrow Colliery demonstrates a closer depiction of the colliery buildings also seen in some of the views. Hare began publishing the prints as sketches of the coal mines in 1839, and soon afterwards advertised them as views of the collieries to be released in parts, which then occurred until the complete volume was published in 1844. This volume includes title pages for both the 1839 and the 1844 iterations of the printed views. The publisher was London-based, but the views were printed locally in Newcastle upon Tyne. And the author of the text, Ross, is noted on this title page, also as the author and editor of other locally printed topographical publications. The volume is quite a substantial publication, physically quite large scale, with 52 pages, including the etchings and illustrated title page. Two of the 42 etchings that appear in the series were used to illustrate the preliminary remarks, with the other 40 accompanied by descriptions of each colliery along the lines of the one that we heard about. This statement from the publication's preface has generated particular interest, in which the authors say, "The coal mines of the north occupy a prominent position in the scale of national production and commerce, but their appearance has been considered so repulsive as to forbid the investigations of the artist." While we know that this claim is not entirely true, I think Hare's endeavour was very unusual and unique in depicting such a large group of northeast collieries in one place in this way. And so unsurprisingly, commentators have emphasised its uniqueness at a time when technical illustrations were more likely to accompany discussions about coal mining than landscapes of this kind. Much depiction of mining-related subject matter in Hare's day, though, was print-based, and the production of this kind of material was increasing at the time that his series appeared. This coincided with, and perhaps contributed to, increasing awareness of working conditions in the mines, with illustrations such as those accompanying the 1842 Royal Commission report on the employment of women and children, apparently having considerable impact. And you can see that those illustrations emphasise the difficulties of a narrow underground landscape, which is in contrast to the wider surface kind of topographical landscape views that were usually employed by Hare in his series. Though in two of the prints, he did attempt to give a sense of the underground world as seen here. But Hare's views and the accompanying text have been criticised for not reflecting the dangerous working conditions and lives of the miners at this time. And the text accompanying the series too communicates the author's appreciation of the coal industry, sometimes almost to the point of romanticising the collieries and the miners, which might be expected for a publication on such a topic that was at least partly funded by colliery owners, which I will come back to. Hare, the son of a lampblack manufacturer, may also, according to records I have found, have been a partner in a coal tar business at the time, and his and Ross's local connections to colliery owners, implied by the text, too, suggest that they were hardly neutral observers of what was then a very dangerous industry. But I would also balance that by saying there are many references within the text accompanying the prints to issues including poor working conditions and disasters such as explosions. So it is not entirely one-sided at a time when political change was beginning to happen. I mentioned that while much mining imagery of the 18th and 19th centuries was printed, it might more often take the form of technical illustrations than landscape prints. But it is important to emphasise that printed views of the wider mining landscape did exist. And I believe that while Hare's endeavour was unusual in its focus and scale, there was an existing context for it, particularly in the northeast, that can help us situate it in its time. To leave northeast England for a moment, and of course we can't look at too many examples of mining landscape prints in general, but I was particularly intrigued to just flag up one example of an unusual series of etchings published a decade before Hare's, depicting mining towns in Mexico. These prints were made after the artist Emily Elizabeth Ward, and I think would be an interesting series to explore another time. And while the next two artists I'm going to mention have been noted before in books referencing Hare's views, I think it would be remiss not to briefly mention some of the best known examples by Turner and Buick as possible precedents for Hare. Turner was more unusual perhaps for actually exhibiting an oil painting landscape of a coal subject in a prestigious forum with his Keelman painting seen in the top left there. I think one of only a couple of coal related paintings shown at the RA around this time. But more in keeping with our prints focus today, the lower left view of Shields was a subject in Turner's River of England series. And I think if you look on the right, you can see Hare covered a very similar subject within his views 20 years later. And Hare surely would also have known Thomas Fuick's views of the Tyne Valley's mining activity made around 50 years before his own, and sometimes relatively hidden as tailpieces in publications such as The History of British Birds. And other print series too, published in the years leading up to Hare's endeavour, would probably also form interesting comparisons. But today I'd like to focus on another relatively little known series, which I think forms an interesting point of comparison with Hare's views. And this project was Blackmore's views on the Newcastle and Carlisle Railway, published in Newcastle, Carlisle and London between 1836 and 1838, and in the full volume in 1839, the same year that Hare's own views began to appear in print. This series was based on drawings by the leading Northeast artist John Wilson Carmichael, and Hare was actually employed this time in the capacity as one of the engravers for this slightly earlier series. This publication's subject matter was similarly modern. It depicted the still in progress railway line between Carlisle on the west to Newcastle on the east. And on the screen, you can see its view of the new Scotswood Railway Bridge, which was actually engraved by Thomas Hare after Carmichael's drawing. These prints were advertised for sale locally at a similar price to Hare's prints and in the same Newcastle newspapers. The format of the series, with brief information accompanying each view, also bears some relation to Hare's endeavour, with both series being sold in parts. And one engraver apart from Hare, Thomas Prior, also contributed to both of the series. And most notably of all, this series didn't ignore the impact of coal on the landscape of the Tyne Valley, as we see here in this view of Wylam. And so it seems that Carmichael and Blackmore did not find Collieries too revolting for consideration, as Hare's preface accuses artists in general. Instead, we find here another print publication that purposefully embraces the modern industrial subjects of the North, and one that Hare actually worked on, perhaps actually simultaneously with the preparation of his own series. I'd now like to think a bit more about how Hare's series was consumed. It's difficult to measure its commercial success, though we know that he was at least in a position to see its various parts through from 1839 to completion. Surviving copies of the 1844 publication can be accessed in some libraries, but are quite rare. And in terms of who else was buying the series, the preface specifically thanks local and national colliery owners for subscribing. As such, these mine owners have been considered the publication's key audience, and Glendenning asserted that the publication's expense as a group of etched views and its specialist subject matter means that it was not intended for a general readership. This may well be so, but some of the general information given within the text and advertisements for the series in regional publications might suggest that Hare hoped to also appeal to a broader local audience, as well as a local and national group of colliery owners. Lists of subscribers for some other locally printed publications may support this possibility if we consider them valid comparisons. For example, Ross, who wrote the text for Hare's series, had previously co-authored and printed the historical, topographical, and descriptive view of the County Palatine of Durham, the first part of which was sold for a shilling in 1830. A list of subscribers for this series was eventually published, and while some are listed as land and colliery owners, most are local working people with disposable income, and there is a wide range of jobs represented, including blacksmiths, builders, farmers, grocers, ironmongers, glass manufacturers, shipbuilders, booksellers, and also a number of pitmen. Subscribers for Mackenzie's An Historical, Topographical, and Descriptive View of the County of Northumberland also included some pitmen, suggesting that there was perhaps an audience there too. Hare advertised his more lavishly illustrated series in parts of three views at a slightly higher price of 2 shillings 6 pence for prints, going up to 4 shillings for an Indian proof. And most adverts I have located appeared in the Newcastle Courant, a paper described in 1846 as having a large circulation throughout Newcastle, North and South Shields, Durham and the Northern Counties, and is taking a particular interest in agriculture, shipping and mining within the area. So perhaps this was the most effective way to reach local land and business owners as well as workers alike. As a point of comparison, the Courant itself cost 5 shillings per quarter in 1839. So one part of Hare's views was around half that. I hope that further study of subscribers and advertisements will help to build a clearer picture of Hare's potential audience and how far colliery views, such as the ones that he made, may have held a more general appeal for audiences within the region. Hare's prints have been consumed both in relation to the text that accompanied them and as standalone views. Today, Hare's prints are probably most often seen within the context of the 1844 volume, either within a special collections library or within a number of facsimiles that have been made after the original books, or I think more commonly now, probably within a Google book that exists. And as such, text and image have usually been considered together, if perhaps too much in isolation from other material of the time. And in terms of the facsimiles in the Google book, without a sense of the materiality of the etchings that you get with the prints and with the original 1844 edition. But other contexts the works might be studied within now do emphasise them as prints. For example, at the Laying Art Gallery, individual sheets are kept in boxes of British landscape prints, alphabetized by location. So in this context, they are seen alongside common air subjects of the day, such as Northumberland's many castles, as well as a handful of other prints depicting the industrial subjects found in the region. By contrast, when Hare's views were pirated in the 1860s, they were reworked to bring the machinery glimpsed in them up to date and placed alongside maps and technical illustrations and text in a category of technical literature outside of art and landscape altogether. This serves to emphasise the series' complexity in terms of the different categories it potentially straddles. Since at least the 1950s, the watercolours have also been seen in art and industrial museum exhibition contexts, often but not always as a standalone group. And I don't have time to go into this in detail, but this slide showing old exhibition posters might give you a brief flavour of that. To conclude then, Most previous research on this series has focused on the collieries that Hare depicted and celebrated the series' unique record of the Northeast mining landscape. While this is valid and forms the key reason that the series has been remembered to the extent that it has, there are arguably wider political, literary, and artistic contexts still ripe for fuller exploration. A key stated aim of Hare's was to see the apparently ignored collieries of the North depicted within landscape art, making the artistic and print production contexts I have touched upon highly relevant. Perhaps in the future, study in fields such as landscape prints, the development of a Northeast regional identity, and of course, a changing climate will lead to new and expanded interpretation of Hare's endeavour, which I do think is a fascinating and genuinely quite unusual series of prints. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lizzie. That was excellent and opens up all sorts of possibilities for further research, as you say. We will now be taking a short comfort break. We'll be starting again in 10 minutes, at about, should we say 10 past, so an 8 minute comfort break. We'll see you all very shortly. Hello everyone, welcome back. Our final speaker today is Dr. Morna O'Neill, who's very kindly joining us from a different time zone. She's Associate Professor of Art History at Wake Forest University. Over to you, Morna.
Thank you. That was exciting. I just had some technical difficulties during the break, but I think we are back. Thanks so much for this opportunity to present this material. And also just a little caveat to say that this is very much a work in progress, a little less polished than the previous two presentations. So I appreciate your patience and also any feedback. In the late 1820s, John Constable embarked on a publication of mezzotints, various subjects of landscape characteristic of English scenery from pictures painted by John Constable RA, now typically referred to as English landscape scenery or English landscape. Engraved by David Lucas, the mezzotints were published in parts between 1830 and 1832, but Constable republished the series in 1833 with extensive revisions. For many art historians, English landscape appears to be a compelling articulation of Constable's artistic identity, a kind of visual autobiography that begins with the artist's own home and functions as a summation of Constable's views about nature and landscape. It is worth recalling that the artist undertook this project during a moment of rapid technological change in printmaking, and this paper will explore Constable's choice of steel as a matrix for these prints. There are 11 surviving steel plates related to this project, and 10 of them are now in the collection of Tate Britain, and I've listed them on this slide. My comments will focus on Spring and Noon, both created under Constable's
supervision. Morna, but your slides are not being, they're not visible at the moment. Did you share?
Oh, no. Okay. That would be terrible. Let me see if I can fix that. Thank you. How about there? Better?
It looks like it's coming up now.
Okay, yeah. Great. Yeah, my computer is cranky this morning. So,
I'll let Shauna help you with this, but just in terms of getting
there, we go. Can you see that now with the list?
It was a bit cropped earlier, but you're okay now.
Okay. Do you see a list? Does that work?
Yeah, plates with Constable supervision.
Perfect. Okay. They're listed on this slide. My comments will focus on Spring and Noon, both created under Constable supervision and included in English landscape. As Anthony Griffiths has noted, the rise of steel had profound consequences for the print trade. Cheaper and harder than copper, steel was more difficult to work but ensured a longer print run. The implications, however, ranged from these practical considerations to the symbolic associations of the material with industry. This talk will explore the use of steel plates in order to reconsider Constable's artistic identity in English landscape, especially in relation to Lucas's artisanal identity and industry. By focusing on the extant steel plates, the correspondence between Constable and Lucas as it pertains to corrections and retouchings, as well as what those negotiations reveal about the dynamic between printmaker and painter, I hope to situate Constable, Lucas, and the works they created together within an emerging culture of the industrialization of print. Steel is an ancient material, but it was not uniformly produced in England until the 1740s. James Watt first suggested the use of steel for engraving in 1812, but the transformation of steel into printing plate only came about in 1819 when Jacob Perkins pioneered the soft steel plate. Steel was treated as iron in a process known as decarbonization to make it softer for the purposes of engraving, and then it was recarbonized as steel before printing. This process required careful attention to method and temperature since the metal could warp, crack, or break during softening or hardening. By September 1820, Perkins had sold 1,000 steel blocks, each 1 inch thick, to mezzotinters. The benefits seemed immediate. plate standardization, lower cost, larger print runs. Some of the extant steel plates for English landscape come from G. Harris and Company, which traded as George Harris until 1832 and then became William Eastwood. So those plates marked Harris, such as Spring and Noon, are from 1832 or before. John Martin also used steel plates from Harris, a number of which survive and are marked with the 51 Shoe Lane address in Farringdon, the firm's premises until 1825. It is likely that they maintained their own production on premises at Harp Alley when they relocated the following year, since that address was registered for fire insurance in 1826. It seemed to be a thriving business. In 1828, George Harris's will lists his employees as a foreman, a clerk, and 7 workmen. The number 4 Harp Alley address appears on the plates for Spring and Noon, while the designation Eastwood for Harp Alley appears on the back of the plate for Gillingham Mill, Dorsetshire, dating it to after 1832. The other and presumably later plates, such as Hampstead Heath, Harrow in the Distance, Mill near Colchester, and Arundel Mill and Castle, come from a Sheffield maker, Register, that is Charles Register and Sons, with premises on Blue Boy Street in the industrial Shalesmore district of the city. As an innovation in printmaking, steel was relatively short-lived, but it flourished in the early 1820s when lithography had not yet taken hold as a print medium. Constable's interest in the effects of chiaroscuro likely influenced his decision to use mezzotint as the medium for his prints. John Fisher suggested in a letter of October 1st, 1822, that the artist consider lithography, but Constable was drawn to the tonal effects achieved only by mezzotint. A letter to Lucas in February 1832 demonstrates how Constable directed Lucas's use of dry point to control light and shade, and in 1833 he added a new subtitle to the work, principally intended to mark the phenomenon of the chiaroscuro of nature. In this regard, the durability of steel created challenges and opportunities. For example, it required a hybrid working method, since the harder steel made the deep blacks less intense than with a copper plate. It was common practice for engravers to etch the main design, especially darker areas, before rocking the remaining ground. The surface of the steel plate for Noon reveals the combined techniques of etching, engraving, and mezzotint, despite extensive rust damage. For example, the sky seems to be conjured by the rough burr created by the mezzotint rocker, while the shorter strokes of etching give form to the grass and shrubbery. The areas of gleaming steel plate form the white wool of the sheep. The harder material required the printmaker to work harder. According to Bamber Gascoigne, a steel plate required about 3 times more rocking than a copper plate. J.M.W. Turner used mezzotint on steel plates for Rivers of England, and he tried steel for the Liber Studiorum, but abandoned it as too difficult. Apparently, he did not get beyond rocking it, and legend has it that he tried a saw blade. Maybe Gillian Forster will have to correct me on that one. The plate for Spring, which Lucas probably began in 1830, suggests the challenges of the material. He rocked the plate with more lateral than vertical pressure, creating an asymmetrical configuration of burrs with areas of deep scraping, etching, and crosshatching. The many proofs suggest the prolonged nature of the back and forth between Constable and Lucas. With each progress proof, Constable is resolving the skies, lightening them over the center of the composition, and delineating the striations in the clouds. Lucas used dry point to add texture to the clouds above the mill in Shirley 7F, scraping out other areas, such as the tree roots in the left foreground, with intensive roulette work, which also appears in the top left corner of the progress proof, Shirley 7G. Lucas's tools are now in the collection of the Fitzwilliam Museum in Cambridge, and the variety of rockers attest to the labor-intensive nature of his work. Perhaps Lucas sought to convey this effort by detailing his exertions to Constable, with notes such as, quote, worked up to this state in one night from 10:30 to 5 in the morning, end quote. Sounds like an undergraduate. With Spring, Constable added the rooks during the proof stages of the engraving, and as a result, the birds are very sharply etched into the plate. Etching also produced the amazing texture achieved in the body of the plow horse. On the plate, some marks vacillate between representation and abstraction as the horizon line disappears into the thicket of crosshatching.
The steel plate could convey these hard-won artistic effects over a longer print run. The introduction to Westmoreland, Cumberland, Durham, and Northumberland Illustrated, Fisher, Son, and Company, 1832, with engravings, after drawings by Thomas Allen and George Pickering, declared that steel engravings were capable of, quote, clothed-like grace and effect, and that they, quote, ushered in a new era in the empire of taste, end quote. The longer print run contributed to this expansion of the art, as prints found a steady market among the growing middle class. Don Martin switched from copper to steel with the engraving of Belshazzar's Feast in 1826, assisted by Thomas Lupton, who was awarded a gold medal by the Society of Arts for his, quote, application of soft steel to mezzotint, end quote. In the 1820s, however, steel engraving was also associated with industrial ideas. Volume, similarity, exactitude, associated with what one critic called, quote, microscopic finish, end quote. Its wider acceptance by the end of the decade also signaled a decline for many, a loss of depth and of richness. Indeed, in C.F. Partington's Engraver's Complete Guide from 1825, he describes engravers as partaking in, quote, mechanical execution and the printing of engraved plates as a, quote, mechanical impression. Partington was also thinking about the ways in which the durability of steel could be used to the advantage of engravers and printers as a labor-saving device, especially when used alongside other devices such as the ruling machine. A steel bar slides back and forth in an even motion, creating a series of close, straight, parallel lines on a grounded plate. Invented by Nicola Conte to assist in the publication of the Description of Egypt, the ruling machine provided a practical solution to Conte's monumental challenge of creating hundreds of engravings. The finished project would include more than 840 plates, many of them on a large scale in a timely fashion. With this new equipment, work that would have taken engravers 6 months could be completed in a few days and with a regularity that only a machine could achieve. In this context, the industrial association of steel as a material came to the fore. It is significant then that Jacob Perkins, whom I mentioned earlier as the pioneer of soft steel plates, undertook his experiments in the hopes of benefiting financially by using the plates to create paper money that could not be counterfeited. An American inventor and mechanical engineer, Perkins traveled to London in 1819 in an attempt to win the £20,000 prize offered by the British government to create unforgeable banknotes. He developed the mechanical process known as siderography, I might need some help with that pronunciation, where an impression is transferred from a steel plate to a steel cylinder and printed using a rolling press. Steel is used here to increase productivity and efface the hand of the artisan. Later in the 1820s, other devices invented by Perkins included a machine that designed its own patterns for banknotes in an attempt to foil counterfeiters, with the goal being to remove the human hand entirely from steel engraving. At the same moment, technical illustrations were also being created as steel engravings, and these images were designed for mass reproduction and distribution. As Francis Robertson has argued, steel engraving began to function as, quote, the embodiment of industrial ideals. Had printmaking likewise descended into the realm of technological innovation and therefore unskilled labor? This question, prompted in part by the rapid expansion of print in the preceding decades, led to the Select Committee of Parliament that convened in June 1836 to investigate the claims of engravers against the Royal Academy. The Academy emphasized the notion that artists were original, while engravers were subordinate, mere copyists. In the Select Committee testimony, the engravers chafed at the characterization of engraving as copying, a description that allied them to the commercial aspects of the practice. I wonder if Constable himself was inspired to comment upon this debate with the fascinating transformation that happens between the first and second state of the vignette Hampstead Heath that concludes English landscape. In the first state, the standing man looks off into the distance and his hands, presumably his sketching, not visible. In the second state, Constable has transformed this figure from an artist sketching in the landscape into a laborer, pick, axe in hand, and gaze downcast. It is as if he is unable or unwilling to appreciate the magnificent sky above him or the rainbow that appeared behind him a feature that was also added in the second state. Is this figure with his pickaxe, a sharpened metal point that breaks the surface, a substitute for the engraver Lucas, resolutely focused on the steel ground in front of him, rather than the expanse of land and sky beyond? Is he slouching off after the completion of this project? He turns his back on the magnificent contrast between light and dark. Constable also introduced a donkey in the second state, a beast of burden who carries the load for others. Constable is using industrial materials and methodologies, availing himself of the strength and reproducibility of the steel plate. At the same time, the reworking, edits, and additions contribute to the sense that the artist is using these materials, or this material, against the grain. The Mezzotints are prints after Constable, yet they often have no exact pictorial reference. Lucas reworked the plates in light of Constable's instructions, and Constable would even alter individual impressions. As Iris Wien has noted, quote, such interventions once again turned the reproduction into an artist's original, end quote. The prints from English landscape are unique and yet repeatable entities. It is also part of the complex ecology of steel described by Tony Fry and Anne-Marie Willis in their study of the material, a web of relations that demonstrates how steel functions in the modern world as material and also, as I hope to explore further, as metaphor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Morna. It's great to see Constable's prints being put into a wider context. I'd like to welcome all our speakers and Mark back now, and we'll convene the panel.
Great, thank you so much. Can you all hear me okay? And thanks so much, Morna, for that really fascinating paper. Wow, all three of you have given us so much to think about. Three fantastic papers. We're sorry there were a few technical issues with the sound, both for Felicity at the beginning and for Amy, I'm afraid. But we were able to, don't worry, Amy, your arguments and your observations did come through loud and clear, even if the sound wasn't always perfect. And luckily, with Lizzie and with Morna, we seem to have avoided those questions, those problems. So what I'd like to suggest is that we have a few minutes where we can respond to each other as part of a panel discussion, questions that you might want to ask each other as speakers, particularly about things that seem to respond or to overlap with your own concerns, your own papers that you've picked up from the other presentations. But also, I'm sure that Felicity and I would love to ask you some questions in response to your presentations as well. And then after a few minutes, we'll turn to our audience and to questions from the audience. We've already got some coming in. Can I please urge those of you who've been watching and listening and enjoying these really complex and fascinating arguments on the part of all three of our speakers, please ask at least a single question, if not more, and then we can feed that response back to all our speakers. We've got plenty of time. We've got half an hour or more to really investigate these subjects and these presentations. So, I mean, I'm very happy to kick off. And I guess the couple of questions really, I guess, for Amy to begin with from me. And I'm sure there are questions that will link all three papers. But Amy, can I just ask you a very basic question about whether you, with your particular vignette or your particular set sheet of images, you saw them in any way as having been produced with a mind to it and an accompanying text, that is there any relationship with either a text that was written, published, or imagined, or does that sheet really stand quite separately from any such commentary?
Yeah, in that case, and in most of the cases of the images that I showed, they weren't particularly intended to go with text. I should clarify, there weren't specific texts that they were supposed to be married to. It was rather a kind of general thing that I think there certainly were narrative accounts of the riots published, and it was assumed that these images would go with them. But I think, I don't know the timings of publications, most of these images, but I get the sense from the kind of the collaborations that either used existing connections or kind of well-tried and trusted partnerships between artist and publisher or printer even. I get the sense that there was rather a scramble to get these prints out there. And I think these artists, by and large, mostly were not working with people who were producing text, except for there was a series of watercolours produced by William James Muller, but that was for a kind of private commission.
Right.
Those watercolours to Grangerize his own kind of luxury account of his riots, which was published. So while they did find their way, into various texts, I don't think they were commissioned or originally conceived as such, although it's inevitable that they would have known that that's how they would have been destined to be used by whoever bought them.
Mm-hmm. Are there any other questions for Amy, particularly from the group? Morna.
Thanks. I put a question in the chat, but I'll just repeat it. I'd love to hear more, Amy, if you've had a chance to think about lithography as a sort of printmaking medium for these images of kind of uprising, revolt, upheaval. It was amazing to see the kind of selection that you showed from around that same period. And I always think of lithography as this kind of smooth stone surface, and yet the images themselves are so, at times violent in their depiction of revolt. And I was wondering if that was ever commented on at the time, that this kind of smooth matrix was creating, part of creating these sort of violent images.
Yeah, it's a really good point to make. I haven't too much, because my initial focus on these images wasn't specifically on them as prints. It was rather the kind of, the image of Bristol that they presented. So I'm coming to the, that more minute focus on them as prints and lithographs, a bit fresher. But I haven't, in looking over the past month or so, I haven't seen any specific references to them as lithographs per se. But you're very right in that there's quite a shocking contrast between, the lithography. So many of these artists' works, and I think it does come across in perhaps volume Picture of Antiquities, it's a very crisp, clean, can sometimes be quite a cold medium. And yet the images that I showed where there was lots of smoke and lots of kind of action, you got a very real sense of the smoke and the dust and the chaos. They don't seem to go, it seems a transformed use of that medium. But I think looking at those images of the French, the July Revolution of 1830, those techniques were certainly in play there. And maybe the connection with France could be explored more, in that, as I said, it was there for its expressive purposes rather than its kind of ability to render detail as you'd need for an architectural illustration or a topographical image. And Tim, I noticed, I just checked the Q&A, Tim Barringer has made the really useful suggestion that I might compare these lithographic representations to those of the 1831 Christmas riots in Jamaica. And he's really usefully given the information that the patrons of those that included slaveholders and members of the West India Company with evident Bristol links. So that even more widely.
Can I ask a question to all three of you about the timing of these different sets you're all looking at? It's very interesting about troubling our sense of what the landscape print series might have looked like. If you think about, the kind of work that Hare is producing, Lizzie, that you looked at, the stuff that you're looking at, Amy, in many ways, the kind of imagery that we've been looking at today is not quite what we might have had in mind, as it were, when we, I think Felicity and I commissioned or convened this series. And then even the way you're talking about Constable and his set and the prints after Constable, Morna, you're making them look very different in a way to how we may have looked at them in the past. And in a way that seems, as we suggested in this, the kind of the title for this, of this particular session, you've been twining them with around industrialization in the way that makes the link between your work and Liz's work so fascinating. and then politics coming into it too. It's an interesting moment about whether you could reflect a bit on the timing that we're talking about here, this really this long 1830s, and about whether you think that's a moment when the aesthetics of landscape imagery and of the print series might be being troubled or becoming so crowded or contradictory or competitive. I'd be some thoughts on whether the genre is undergoing some kind of change or crisis at the time.
I can probably answer that quite, with some initial thoughts. I think Turner's activity in the field of print series and printmaking is quite an indicator that the market was becoming very saturated and that things were changing. And just from, certain of the later print series either didn't come to fruition or didn't, they weren't as successful as earlier print series, certainly. So that's an indicator that something in the 1830s was changing. But then from looking at lithography, I think the 1820s was still a period when it was being refined and when it was being promoted and used, but not to the exhaustive amount that Morna referenced in her paper, where later lithography is a kind of primary medium and it's used in a lot of reportage, it's used in the London Illustrated News and with woodcuts, and it becomes that kind of almost cheapened mode of reproduction. I think that there was definitely towards the end of the 1830s a shift there in such a way that had the timing of the Bristol Riots been different, I wonder what medium these artists would have preferred their images to be circulated within then, you know, if it was later. Whereas in the early 1830s, particularly if you look at France and the kind of academic privileging of lithography there, it does seem to have still had a kind of some degree of prestige attached to it and speed, which was necessary, but you know, it wasn't too far distanced from mezzotint, from the kind of more traditional forms of engraving then.
Yeah, Morna and Lizzie, I wondered about the overlaps that you saw between the imagery you're looking at.
Lizzie, I think we unmuted at the same time. Would you like to go ahead?
Oh, you can go first and then I'll follow.
Well, I was just going to say quickly that one of the things that has interested me in thinking about your question, Mark, is to look at, theories of remediation. So, one of the surprising things for me when I started looking at these prints was the fact that steel was the matrix for them. And so I was trying to think about how a new media, as it were, gets incorporated into an older practice and then also sort of transforms that practice. And I think that you're absolutely right that there is a kind of crisis happening in the 1830s, but I feel, you know, as someone whose primary research topics usually fall later, what I am finding so fascinating and wonderful that many of you already know about the 1830s is that it seems to be a kind of full of moments of crisis. And so it's interesting to think about how, sort of artistic questions around landscape in many ways go hand in hand with bigger questions about religion, politics, industry, and to see the kind of aesthetics of landscape as a sort of formulative partner in those debates, rather than merely kind of reflecting them, as it were, which I think is maybe a more traditional reading.
Lizzie.
Yeah, I think in Hare's case, it's quite interesting because a number of the existing images that showed mining, such as the slightly kind of crude woodcuts that I showed alongside the report, were not very similar to Hare's etchings. And at the kind of time that he was working, the sort of amount of printed imagery and including printed imagery of mining was sort of increasing at that same time. And sort of not that long afterwards, you get things like the wood engraved illustrations and the Illustrated London News that would have shown more of the lives of the miners and things. But I think Hare sort of has an interesting position in that, because he's almost like quite consciously, if we believe what he says in the preface, elevating these subjects into a field of kind of landscape prints that he might have associated more with the likes of Turner, and kind of trying to bring them back into that, I guess, what was that point, very well established sort of idea of a series of kind of finer landscape prints. So I think that's all really interesting in relation to him. And that's kind of why the more that I've got into thinking about the series, the more I think it's just sort of never ending, really, is to trying to understand that wider context and why these images were unusual, and if they were unusual. And the choice of etching as well is quite interesting.
Thank you. Felicity, did you want to ask questions of the panel before we turn to our growing list of questions from the audience? Yeah.
Sure. Well, maybe just a general question for everyone. And you've all touched on this in different ways, but what do you feel is unique about the series itself? What is it about issuing images together that we should be looking at? What does it bring to the table, so to speak?
Any responses?
I think that's a really, it's a difficult question, but having is picking up on what Lizzie was saying just then about the kind of the suitability, as it were, of certain features of a landscape, the suitability of those features for different registers of artistic production. I've thought about that a lot in relation to other parts of work that I've done, particularly when it comes to the industrial landscape of the industrial shoreline. That the print series does, you know, we have this sense of hierarchy that's imposed on us through our historical education quite often. And actually, I find that the print series is really liberating and exciting, because you find things within these series that you don't necessarily find elsewhere. And so that's where I think the series has great value. And also it allows you to, it's more, you know, thinking about the way in which an idea is articulated across, through a piece of work, you then have a body of work to think about, which even if it's one artist behind the series, as the case of Constable, or multiple artists in the case of many of the topographical series or volumes that go with text, you have a kind of essay, as it were. So you have multiple paragraphs of ideas playing out within one whole that you can look at all together. So I think, you know, for viewers then, that creates a more complex and fascinating choice, and for us too. But then, as I mentioned in my paper, there's also that danger, and Lizzie mentioned it too, of seeing works you can then take them. Lots of pitfalls too about working across series, that there's more.
Thanks, Amy. Morna and Lizzie, that are your thoughts on this issue of the series?
Well, Lizzie, you let me go first last time, so would you like to take a turn?
Oh, thank you. I mean, it's such an interesting question more broadly, but I guess in terms of Hare series specifically, it's quite an interesting one, because I'm not sure if I actually said this during my talk or not, but one of the things that's said in the preface to the series is that he's hoping to actually suggest a new field of artistic sort of illustration. Like, it's that kind of lofty idea that this series, by kind of presenting all of the Collieries together in this way, will suggest a whole new subject matter for artists almost. And I think for Hare, the fact that he created the whole series may have been entwined with his own idea of creating an artistic legacy. Because he kind of believed he was filling this vacuum that nobody else had done. And I suppose it has, I mean, it's borne out really, because he's not very well remembered, but I don't think he'd be remembered at all if it wasn't for this series.
I'll just jump in and say that I think with English landscape, there's almost a sense of it as a kind of organic entity that grows and changes over time. And as you wonderfully discuss, Felicity, in your recent Tate papers essay, it has an afterlife that's really colored how it's perceived and how it's talked about today. And one of the things that I find to be a particular challenge is, you know, how can you say something new about Constable at this point? And so I found that thinking about this series in relationship to material was one way to maybe estrange Constable a little bit from this project and provide a kind of new way of thinking about it.
I was struck, Lizzie, when you talked about, with the advert you showed about the part, I mean, it is this issue about installments or releasing a series in parts. I think that is a fascinating aspect of so many of these series that they're done in that way. And that Hare was, but he was quite, not vague, but not entirely certain about the timetable for their release, wasn't he, in that advert? But then that sense of subscribers getting groups of these images and then waiting for the next group, and that idea of something that is collected and comes together over time, where sometimes that might be a very rational and a carefully regulated process, and other times, even with Turner's Lieber, with other examples, it's a much more haphazard, the gaps between installments is not, you know, that whole idea of the release dates and the timetables of release, shifting that sense, you know, the sense of how one actually consumes these as in growing and unfolding pieces of work. Okay, look, I'm sorry, I'm looking conscious of time, and we have lots of participants, lots of questions. So can we start hitting the questions? I'm going to do that. Is that okay, Felicity, if I just start reading out some of the questions, maybe? So we'll, going back to Amy, and there's a couple of questions from John Hinks. One about whether these prints were printed and published locally in Bristol or in London. I think you touched on that, and about the print runs of any of these images. Do you have a sense of scale? And finally, complementing that, a question from Julia Elkerton, what's the market for these prints? Who are the buyers of the depictions of the riots and fires? Any thoughts you might have on that, sort of those related questions?
Well, these are the things when working on prints and print series that I've always got these questions in my mind, and they're not necessarily as easy as I'd like them to be. So I don't have any figures for the print runs of these images, but I do know certainly I found an advert for one that went into a second print run. So that's, you know, evidently there was a kind of a demand there. And then what was the other part of the question? They were published in London and Bristol. So it seems publishers and booksellers joined forces with London printsellers and and publishers to make sure there was a greater field of distribution of these works, that, you know, they were perhaps local impetus but then a national distribution. And the other part of the question, who would consume them? Well, that's, you know, in the advert I think that I discussed, that's the greatest clue for that so far. People who were collectors of topography, people who had a particular interest in Bristol, but also, as the advert suggests, a history of England. You know, this was a national event that should be registered in your right. So that this was, you know, certainly had a broad appeal. And I think in terms of the kinds of people, the, you know, the typical market for prints, topographical prints in particular, kind of middle class, genteel audience who wanted to be seen to be part of that discussion, part of those conversations about the places and their importance. So I hope that answers those questions.
Yeah, thanks, Amy. There's a question from Gillian Forrester in response to Lizzie, your talk, Lizzie, about the fact that for Gillian, the execution of the Collieries prints reminded her of John Sell Cotman's antiquarian etchings. And she wonders if Hare is also appealing to an antiquarian market, or simply unconsciously absorbed that style, as there are not many precedents for his industrial subject matter? And I think that is a really interesting question, the relationship between this new imagery of industrialization and the antiquarian imagery. And it'd be good to get your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I get the feeling myself that although the kind of context for images of mining at the time was not so much in the field of landscape, although hopefully I showed it, there was some precedent, that Hare really is somebody who was working as a commercial engraver as well, and was involved in other series, and I think probably had a good knowledge of other topographical print series. And it feel like reading through the views of the Collieries does feel a little bit like reading through a more traditional topographical publication. Of it's almost like the Collieries are in place of the great houses, and there is that sort of shared sense of that sort of aesthetic tradition there to some extent, although obviously they are industrial subjects and they do look different. But yes, my opinion is that he was very much looking at those kind of precedents and artistic precedents as much as just the, you know, being shoehorned into that kind of idea that they're industrial or technical in some way.
A follow-up question from Sally Bills, which for you, Lizzie, which I think is really interesting, about whether you think this imagery of industrialization, Sally was asking about whether industrialization was seen as part of the economic holdings of the countryside estates that was celebrated by landowners. I was struck by the fact that there was a mention that one of the collieries was owned by a marquis, and you talked about the fact that the owners of these collieries seem to have played an important role in the publication, if not exclusive one. Are those images of collieries now becoming part of the kind of pictorial paraphernalia of land ownership and of local power, do you think? I think that's Sally's point.
I think it probably needs further research to try and figure out how much all the landowners would have been pleased that those aspects of their land ownership were appearing in print. But obviously we do know that at least some of her subscribers were colliery owners. But as you've just sort of hinted at yourself, while we might think of the mines being run by industrialists, a lot of the money was still with quite traditional landowners in the area, such as like in Northumberland, the Percy family. So it's quite a diverse and interesting picture, I think. And actually, I think that would be a really interesting point to take forwards and think about more. So thank you.
And maybe, sorry, Lizzie, one last one for you, then there are plenty for you as well, Morna. But there's a question from Iris Veen for you, Lizzie, which is about whether you'd come across comparisons, metaphorical comparisons between cathedrals and industrial buildings and structures. She was reminded that the depiction of the Percy main colliery with its special perspective over the corner might remind one of cathedral paintings. So the kind of the idea of these structures as kind of modern cathedrals.
Oh, well, I love that point. I think that's fascinating. To be honest, no, not really. But I guess one thing I might link back to the publication is that the language that is used in some of the text accompanying the views sort of glorifies coal and, you know, the treasure and everything it brings to the economy in a way that is almost glorifies in a similar kind of way. And it's obvious that both Hare and Ross, who provided text, have mixed feelings about the mines, but they are just celebrating and glorifying the industry to quite an extent in the text. That's really interesting about cathedral imagery, and another thing for me to think about some more. So thank you.
There are questions for you, Morna. There's one from Annie Lyles, actually. The great Constable expert, of course. And Annie asked, do you think it might have been Constable himself who opted for steel for the metzitants of English landscape, or else Lucas, the engraver? If the latter, might Lucas have been influenced in the adoption of steel by having experience working with this new service when in S.W. Reynolds' studio?
I think it's a wonderful question. And I think I'm still trying to figure out the answer to that one. Obviously, as she points out, Lucas was already familiar with the material, but it just seemed such a strange honestly, it just seems such a strange decision to me that Constable would have chosen steel. So I wonder if it had something to do with Lucas's input, chiefly because I think there are still all sorts of very valid questions about what Constable hoped to achieve with this series. And you know, the chief advertisement of steel would have been that you could make many more of them. And you know, there's been much discussion in the scholarship about the failure, potentially we could say, the failure of this project, or the fact that it didn't sell well, it didn't reach a large audience, that there were so many that were auctioned off after Constable's death. So I think it's a wonderful question, and I think it's for future consideration.
I have a question from Victoria Hepburn, again for you, Morna, who says she's really interested in the issue of rust on the steel plates, a problem that Lupton admitted to and is aware of when he received his gold medal. Any thoughts on that problem in relation to the themes of your paper?
Well, I think that's also a great question, and there's no sort of discussion in the correspondence between Constable and Lucas that I've come across yet that might be something that they're worried about, but it definitely would have been something to worry about. And in fact, in the images that I showed of the extant plates, there are a few that have significant rust damage. And that was perceived as the kind of chief vulnerability of steel as a material, in addition to the kind of trickiness of the decarbonization, recarbonization project. So again, I think that's a wonderful question, and that's definitely one for further consideration.
Thanks. I've got a few more questions that are here that are sort of jump around between speakers, if that's okay. So I'll jump back to you, Lizzie, if that's okay. Liz, John Hinks asks whether you're familiar with R.S. Chadwick's prints of the industrial landscape of the Black Country. There's some interesting similarities, but he admits that these are later prints than the ones that you're discussing.
I'm afraid I'm not, but I will make a note of that and look them up. So thank you.
And Paul Spencer Longhurst, Lizzie, asks whether you think the vignette format has particular relevance or importance for these industrial views.
Yeah, that's an interesting one that I've sort of been pondering the whole time I've been looking at them. Most of the images in the series are in the vignette form, although not actually all of them, which in itself is quite interesting. They're actually, I think I mentioned, they're quite large. So they're not, you know, like Buick's tiny vignettes. They're nothing like that. They're quite large scale. And I wondered whether perhaps the fact that a number of mining illustrations are, you know, were made as book illustrations. So you do see the kind of technical illustrations of the mines are often in the vignette form. So I don't know whether that influenced it, or perhaps in my mind, it's more likely that Hare studying examples by Buick, who I'm sure he would have known Buick's prints well. But also I think looking at Hare's watercolors, I think he knew Turner's example well. And one of the first things I thought when I saw the watercolors themselves at the Hatton was that they really reminded me of Turner's vignette watercolors in the Turner Bequest. And that's just, you know, that's just sort of my opinion having seen them, but it's definitely made me wonder about that. So I suppose the short answer is I don't know, but I think, you know, it may be that some of these influences were at play when he decided to go with the vignette form for a number of the prints.
Matt, this is a question I think for actually probably all of you, but there's a question from Marius Quint, who's asking about the theme of the disruptions of modernity becoming rendered as fine, or I guess pleasure, a certain kind of pleasurable visual spectacle, or the sublime in some of the prints discussed. He asked whether that'd be too bold an appraisal, that sense of even something like the riots in Bristol being turned into this kind of spectacular visual spectacle, Amy, or the collieries that you were looking at, Lizzie, whether they actually can become transformed into something like, you know, the volcanic eruptions of Vesuvius or something like that, or whether that's the case for Constable's clouds, who knows? But I mean, what are your thoughts on this issue about whether these disruptions of modernity, of contemporary life, actually being translated into something which have kind of sublime aesthetic appeal.
I think in the case of the riots, that's definitely the case, and it's not too bold and appropriate at all. I think that was part of the kind of the appeal, certainly of the distant view. It's a very shocking and striking image. So I think, yeah, that's certainly an effect that the artists behind them were going for.
Is a tradition of images of cities on fire that they relate to?
I mean, I suppose the Great Fire of London is the only thing in mind. I haven't really had not much chance to go into, but I think just looking through them, it's certainly fire is used. You know, it's used to silhouette the ruins of the buildings, and it's used to kind of signal from afar that something is very wrong in this city. So it's definitely used as a visual tool to draw people in and to make the, in the case of the prints, you know, visually exciting.
Lizzie, Morna, any more thoughts in response to Maris's question about,
I think it's very similar with her, although he sort of specifically says that you know, he's not using artistic effects to enhance the images. I think he does, and the fire, though, the use of fire as well is quite interesting in the more dramatic of the scenes. And yeah, I mean, they are quite a mixture of images, but certainly the ones that I pointed to during the PowerPoint, I think they do kind of fall into that tradition of the idea of the sublime landscape imagery and sort of employing that in the depiction of the dramatic potential of industrial scenes.
Morna, any thoughts?
I had one thought by saying that in some ways, I feel like we're back at your original point, Mark, about the sort of 1830s and this kind of disruptions of the aesthetics of landscape. So that in many ways it feels like that kind of aesthetic question with which you began is you know, right, the same question really as this theme of the disruptions of contemporary life.
Mm. Well, given we've circled back, maybe that's an appropriate, and it is 2 minutes past two, in fact, so we're running slightly late. I think maybe we should draw it to an end there. Huge thanks, Amy, Lizzie, Morna. I'm sure, well, Felicity will no doubt want to join me in thanking you all for three tremendous papers. I can't tell you how pleased we both are to have such, we always knew this would be the case, we'd have such a strong start to our series, but you set the bar very high in terms of the level of analysis and interpretation that you've offered us. And I think you've just brought this whole subject of the landscape print series alive in your very different ways so brilliantly today. So many, many thanks to you all. And we very much hope you'll continue to join us as the series unfolds and bring your contributions to bear on the presentations by other speakers. And just to say that the next installment of this series we talk about Hare issuing his prints in parts, Lizzie. Well, we're doing something rather similar. We have another set of talks coming up on Thursday. We hope we can be even more regular than Hare was. We know there's going to be Thursday, next Tuesday, and the following Thursday. And you'll get this fantastic sequence of a talk series, I suppose we should call it, unfolding over the next couple of weeks. So beginning, the next stage of which is on Thursday. So I hope you'll join us then. Felicity, any other thoughts, final thoughts you wanted to offer?
So thank you again. We look forward to the next ones. Just echoing your thoughts.
Yeah. And thanks to the team at the PMC who've had to actually cope with some quite challenging issues today, technically. The fact that we got through to 2 o'clock and managed to enjoy such fantastic papers is a testament to all the work they've been putting in behind the scenes as well. Thanks, everyone. And see you all again, I hope, on Thursday. Okay, bye-bye for now.
Say thanks if you're still there, Shauna. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thanks, everyone, for joining us, and we'll see you on Thursday.
All right.